Welcome back, everybody. This is episode number 2 of the ultimate walkthrough for Bloodborne. We're going to go ahead and defeat Father Gascoigne and then move on to the Cathedral Ward area. All right, so for that process, we're going to basically head over to Central Yharnam. Okay, and once we're here, we want to make sure that we do have the right things equipped. We may use Molotovs in the fight, so if you want to also have the oil urn equipped as well to do an extra damage, you can feel free to do that. Definitely want to also have the tiny music box equipped. That's going to be important for us. And let's see here. We do want to make sure that we have the axe as well. This is going to be, it's going to make the fight a lot easier for us to have that extended range so that we can use the surrounding area in the fight to our advantage. Okay, so let's just go ahead and make our run towards the boss zone. There's no reason to fight any of these enemies here. Just gonna run straight through and get to the elevator. You don't even need to wait those guys out. If they're down a little bit closer to the staircase, you can just run by them and hop on this elevator here. Now, if you for some reason didn't grab the tiny music box, that means that you still need to talk to Gascoigne's daughter. So, her ladder can be found down below here and just down the hallway. If you climb the ladder at the end and go up to the top there, you should be able to locate her quest as well. So let's get here. We're going to turn around. I know if you've watched the first episode, you've already gotten all this stuff, but I kind of just want to go over it again, just so it's fresh in your mind. All right, go ahead and kill this guy. Sometimes one or two of them will survive. Make sure to get any extra loot that you can. Now, we don't need to fight these two enemies up here. We've already done this before, so there's nothing to grab or learn from. Just pass by like that. These guys are hiding an item right there. So what I like to do is use a Molotov. You take one out and then you deal with the next one. See if we can get him closer. There we go. Obviously, these are great recall items. Allow us to go back to the last place we rested without losing any of our blood echoes. So when you go through this archway here, the boss fight will start. You'll get a cutscene first, but if you do happen to die to the boss, going forward, it will be a fog gate that you can pass through, but the fight starts immediately after that. So make sure that you instantly move to the right. Whether you're moving through a fog gate or the cutscene is ending, you're going to immediately move to the right and try to put the tombstones in between yourself and Father Gascoigne. So at this point, we want the music box and our axe in its trick formation. All right, we're not going to use the music box until the beginning of the phase where he turns into a beast form. That's very important. You can use it more than that, but it's most effective to use it at the third phase, and the way we're going to fight him, we won't need to use it at any other point. Okay, so here are the tombstones that I'm talking about. You go ahead and target lock them. He's only using the axe one-handed at this point, so we know he can shoot and use his weapon, but he can't really reach us too effectively when we hide behind these tombstones here. The gun will hit us, but, you know, it's not very powerful at this point. As you can see, we can take damage as we come in for our swing. Alright, so once he gets into his second phase, he's gonna extend the weapon. We'll see him do it now. So he's gonna shoot less, and that makes it easier for us to parry him if you want to break away from these tombstones here. He can obviously reach through, because so can we. But you can still use this tactic throughout. You can use this tactic the first and second phases. You just have to be aware of his range. And it's just as good as ours. See, he'll still be able to hit us. He can do significant damage. He's clearly much more aggressive. But again, his swings are very long and wound up. So if you want to go faster through this process, you can definitely use your gun. As you can see, it's problematic because he's so fast with it. Alright, so he's probably gonna transition here. We'll go ahead and use the music box. He doesn't like that. You get behind him, charge up an attack. And you can either get aggressive with this, but you need to make sure that you're ready to back away at any time. So essentially, if you're not confident with that third phase, what you want to be doing is backing away, target locking, and using your Molotov cocktails. If for whatever reason he's extremely aggressive and you can't shake him, what you're wanting to do is run over here. Or basically any area with a tree and a statue. And you can body block him from that. He can destroy the tombstones that we were utilizing earlier. So this tree and statue is good. That one over there is good. And there could be other, but those are the two that I tend to use because they're close together. And so it's easier to get to and rotate between if you do happen to get caught. Alright, so what you'll want to do now is you can activate the lamp. We're going to go ahead and run up these stairs. And grab the item on the top of this little structure here. So we've got the red jeweled brooch. You can go ahead and inspect the item. A woman's bright red brooch engraved with the name Viola. Perhaps the jewel is a gift from a hunter, used to change into a droplet blood gem that fortifies any weapon. With the proper workshop tool, various weapons can be fortified. So once we get the workshop tool, we'll be able to add upgrades to our weapon. This item specifically needs to be equipped in your inventory and used, or just use it from this section here. So if we were to click on it, select use, what would happen is he would break the brooch and we would use the red bloodstone gem to place on our weapon. I suggest you decide whether you want to give this back to the daughter or keep it for yourself. However, the quest line should indicate your choice be to keep it for yourself, because it's not going to benefit you in any meaningful way to give it back to her other than your own peace of mind. The music box won't really be important for us to use. There are things that you can do with it to kind of glitch out enemies in certain situations. It's more experimental than anything else. I would say don't keep it in your quick item menu for sure. So go ahead and bring that out. You can add the pebbles back now. And before you go back, what we're going to do is continue forward. We want to get to the next zone. because that's going to allow us to continue some of the quests further on. So there's really no danger between here and where we're headed. So even if you're low health and worried about potentially getting injured, there's no real concern, unless you were to fall by some chance. So we'll climb up the ladder here. The next room, there's going to be some items that we need to pay attention to. There's a little lore piece right here. The Bergenworth spider hides all manner of rituals and keeps our lost master from us. A terrible shame. It makes my head shudder uncontrollably. Now again, this is so early in the game that a lot of the lore isn't going to make much sense to you at this point. So just kind of store those away in your memory banks as best you can. And here's the workshop tool that I was just discussing with you. You don't need to break the red brooch just yet. In fact, when you get to the girl that you got the quest in the music box from, it's going to be a little bit easier for you to move through the conversation piece once you have that in your belongings. So let's open up this door here. Okay, now you can see we're at the Cathedral Ward, and I wouldn't blame you for thinking this thing is probably going to be a villain. The dialogue that we go through and just the laughter at the end of it, FromSoft has kind of conditioned us to think that this is a villain here. So don't be confused. You can make your decisions up on your own if they're good or not, but if you play out through the process, for the most part they seem pretty harmless. Events do occur in this cathedral that might make you think something is awry. But you have to make sure that you do the proper steps in order to avoid certain situations. So there's really no way that I can avoid giving you spoilers and still guide you in the proper direction at the same time for this instance. So I'm going to caution you from killing this NPC. There are other NPCs that will eventually join you here in the cathedral. And there is one NPC in particular that will begin killing the others if you invite them here. So I'll definitely caution you in that situation when we meet that individual NPC. But unless I direct you specifically to avoid sending them here, you'll send any NPCs that are asking for assistance to this place. So let's go ahead and talk to this NPC right here.
Hmm? Oh, you must be a hunter. Very sorry. The incense must have masked your sin. Good, good. I've been waiting for one of your ilk. These hunts have everyone all locked up inside, waiting for it to end. It always does, always has, you know, since forever. But it won't end nicely, not this time. Even some folks hiding inside are going bad. The screams of women folk, the stench of blood, the snarls of beasts, none of them's too uncommon now. Yharnam's done for. Tell ya. But if you spot anyone with their wits about them, tell them about this here Erden Chapel. They'll be safe here. The incense wards off the beasts. Spread the word. Tell them to come on over. If you wouldn't mind.
Okay, so the voice and the dialogue seems really normal and innocent enough until the laughter comes in. And that combined with the appearance of the NPC really gives you suspicious feelings that, hey, why are they actually inviting these NPCs to come over for safe haven? Are they truly good intentioned? If I just had to go off of my gut intuition, I would have said no. And in fact, I've killed this NPC for that reason alone. So I'm just protecting you from drawing that conclusion yourself. They are, in fact, innocent and good.
be asking you, but if you happen upon someone while hunting, tell them about this here Erden Chapel. If they seem worth being told, that is. Oh, and I do sincerely hope they are.
Okay, so that's the only conversation dialogue we have with them at this point. Once we actually direct someone here safely, which we already know that the rude old lady is looking for someone to go, somewhere to go, rather. So we'll send her here, and once we initiate dialogue again with this NPC, we'll receive a new gesture. Okay, so let's go ahead and light the lamp. And we'll go ahead and head back to the Hunter's Dream. Okay, so there's a couple things I want to do here. First of all, we have lots of currency to spend here at the Insight Merchant. So let's go ahead and scroll over to the right, and we can see that we can get Father Gascoigne's attire. I typically use Insight for these kind of rare purchases. We've discussed Insight earlier and the effects of having a lot of it on your character at any one time. Typically, it's a negative effect, and I would suggest doing multiple playthroughs in your Bloodborne career. That way, you can experience the game with high Insight and then the game with low to normal Insight. It's quite a different experience for sure. All right, so now that we have that attire, we can go ahead and swap to it. It's not that it's much more or less effective. It's just really, I like to do the different stylings. It's kind of fun. It gives the game a little bit of flavor. And I really like the look of this set specifically. It's really cool in my opinion. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and talk to Garmin here.
The moon is close. It will be a long hunt tonight. If the beasts loom large and threaten to your spirits, seek a holy chalice, as every hunter before you has. A holy chalice will reveal the tomb of the gods, where hunters partake in communion.
I mean, to the unknowing, a lot of these dialogue experiences are really confusing and seem like they could be gibberish. It's hard to determine if it matters or not. But he's actually giving you very important information. How you can decipher what all of this means, I don't really know. It's hard to do that when you haven't already played the game. It does seem quite a challenge to try to decode everything that these NPCs tell you. So thankfully there are guides and things like that to hold your hand along the way if you just want to know the first time through, or even the second or third. A lot of these things are really hard to figure out. So, essentially, it's important to know that the moon and the cycles of night really play a huge deal in this game. When you defeat certain bosses or get to certain areas, it changes the moon specifically and the time phase. That will push quests further along, or if you haven't done the proper things up to that point, it will lock them out. And you'll no longer be able to finish them appropriately. So it's very important to pay attention to the directions that I give you with certain NPCs, because the timing will play a huge deal in completing those quests. And they don't really give you any indicator on how or when you should be doing those things. So that's the biggest bummer about doing NPC storyline quests in FromSoft games. There's very little hand-holding and very little understanding on when and where to do certain things. So just, I'm going to make sure that you're well aware of when to visit certain NPCs, and we'll go through that process as this guide plays out together. So if you're playing alongside me, which is the idea of the guide, you'll be all set and we'll do just fine. Let's see if Garmin has anything else to add.
Most of the holy chalices lie within the tomb of the gods, and the few that found their way to the surface were lost again in the hands of men. But if the old hunter tales remain true, one of the holy chalices is worshipped in the valley hamlet. Yet the town is in disarray. It was burned and abandoned for fear of the scourge. Home now only to beasts. The perfect place for a hunter, wouldn't you say?
Okay, so that's the end of his dialogue here. Now we want to do this real quick. We're going to head over to the workshop. We're going to fortify our weapon. And we currently don't have enough shards for that. And I want to caution you before you do any kind of blood gem fortification. We currently have the item, the red brooch, that we can destroy and use an upgrade for. We're going to wait until we go ahead and deal with the young daughter's quest line. Then we'll come back and finish that process. Alright, so we don't need to worry about spending our blood echoes at this point, because we're just going to do some quest completion type stuff at the moment. So we're going to head back now. And to begin this process, it's probably best that we start from Central Yharnam so that we can deal with the quest giver over there. And you might not even realize that you're on a quest when you talk to certain NPCs. They give you instructions and directions on where to go and what to be doing, but they don't necessarily ask you for any assistance. So this is why you may not come back to this window and think to talk to this NPC, but in fact you do need to do that.
You needn't concern yourself with me. I'm afraid I'm of little help now. But before I...
Alright, so we get essentially a flamethrower. It's called the Flame Sprayer in this game, and it uses bullets, just like our guns would.
I made no use of it, but perhaps you. What afflicted me was incurable, but this time gave me hope. Their strange blood bought me time. I was most fortunate. Unharmed by the plague of beasts, I can even die human. Don't you worry about me.
Okay, and he's gonna repeat that same action if we continue to try to talk to him. We will not get this dialogue nor the item until we go to the Cathedral Ward. After you kill Father Gascoigne, if you just return here without activating the lamp at Cathedral Ward, he won't have any idea of what you've done. So this is directly a result of defeating Father Gascoigne and then activating the lamp at the Cathedral Ward. Alright, so there's still more to come with this NPC, but nothing absolutely essential. And those are going to be time-gated things as well, so we'll discuss those when the appropriate time comes, but for right now, you've done your job with this particular NPC. Now, there's a couple different ways to get to the young daughter, and I like to go to her quest from the Father Gascoigne boss fight. So we're going to go to the tomb. And now we're going to work our way back. There's not a whole lot of stuff to kill here. The flaming ball of hay will actually still be kicked in that direction. We can walk by these guys, so you don't need to worry about the aggro here. I found that this is the path of least resistance. So you can see those guys running already. He's going to kick the ball in a second here. So just take that guy out first, and then you can just run past this guy. Well, if I didn't have target lock on, that would have been a lot easier. So we're just gonna run down here and defeat this one enemy. You can actually walk if you want. The big guy won't chase you past the midpoint of the bridge. Go ahead and pick up any loot that they've happened to drop. Now we're just going to descend down the ladder here. When you get to the bottom, you're going to quickly run all the way up the stairs and up the next ladder that we can see up ahead here. If you do that, you will never be touched by these enemies down below. There's no reason to fight them whatsoever. We're going to go up this second ladder here. And again, a quick climb, if you just press up on the thumbstick and hold down the circle button, you'll be able to quick climb. Now you can already hear the enemy over here, and we've dealt with this guy before. He's such an easy kill that you might as well do it. The birds behind us are really slow to chase for some reason. I mean, this is essentially free loot and free blood echoes, so you might as well kill that guy. It's such a slight detour in your time here. Alright, so we are at the quest-giving destination. Remember, there are choices to be made, and I highly suggest that you do not give her the brooch. And then second, you're going to tell her to head to the chapel or the cathedral ward. So do not give the brooch.
Oh, okay. I can wait. But isn't there something I can do? Maybe Mom and Dad are stuck out there, waiting for me to come and find them. What do you think, Mr. Hunter?
Go ahead and tell her of the chapel.
Yes, okay. Thank you, Mr. Hunter. I love you almost as much as Mom and Dad. And Granddad.
Okay, so there's really nothing more to say to her. The sad thing about this is that she is going to head out on her way, and unfortunately she will be killed. She's actually going to be killed by the hog down in the sewers. So what we do here is we're going to force close our game, and then we're going to continue it. And this is going to allow us to progress her movement. You could also visit the lamp, the lantern, and then return, but obviously there's way more work than we should be expected to do just to advance her progress here. Okay, now clearly we can see she's moved on because there's no light inside. If you go up to the window, there's nothing going on. So what we need to do is travel back down below. And we're going to make our way all the way back to where the hog is. Now you can go behind the hog and then get that visceral attack like we did in the last episode. I'm gonna show you the other way to defeat the hog. It does add an element of risk, but it should still fairly be simple for you. Alright, so at the start, we're just going to start sprinting through. He's going to yell at us, and then get behind. Oh, my target lock didn't work. He's very easy to hit with crits, as you can see. Super slow. Once you defeat it, it should drop two items. You're going to get blood vials, and then you're going to get the red messenger ribbon. So we'll take a look and see exactly what that is. It's going to be in your key items section of the inventory. The red ribbon that messengers are oddly fond of, the thick, pungent red, was drawn from the organs of some unfortunate victim. A strange choice indeed, but perhaps for the messengers wearing this accessory constitutes a form of mourning. Okay, so obviously this is a decorative item for our messengers, and there'll be many more of these type of items to come. But we can actually continue on the little girl's quest line, because she does have a sister. And at a certain point, we'll be able to go back to that home and interact with her sister that will be there. She's not there now, obviously, but later in the game, we'll be able to do that. And then we'll be rewarded with the white ribbon by continuing that story quest. So it's not entirely done, although the young girl is dead at this point. And there's really no way that you can avoid that. So don't worry about it. It is worth sending her down that path, because we do want to get the items. All right, so now we're in a position where we can go ahead and return back to the lamp. You guys can head back to the lamps yourself. I'm gonna go ahead and use one of our hunter's mark to save a little bit of everybody's time. Okay. Now all we need to do here is go ahead and return to the hunter's dream. And this is something that I've pointed out earlier. If the doll is not at this location, then she is almost certainly over here by this tombstone. This will have some significance to you later on. There's an alternate dream, a hunter's dream type of place, where this tombstone will have an item. We'll explain more about that when we get to it. But that is why she comes over here. And you can still do all the normal interactions with her, just like you would. But she just happens to be in a different place. So don't be confused if you don't see her right next to the tombstone where you're used to.
Welcome home. What is it?
Alright, so we're going to channel some blood echoes. But we don't want to do too many, because we still want enough to work on our weapon. So we're going to just bump up twice here. And then now we're going to go into our inventory. We're going to find the red. Oops, I must have passed it. Yeah, I did. We're going to use this. And now we have the red blood gem. So that when we approach, we can do the red, we can do the blood gem fortification. And you can see here, under the blood gem effects on the right center, it says physical attack up by 2.7% and boost rally potential by 1.8%. The rally potential is what I call regain in this game. When you take damage and you have that small window of time to also deal damage and recover your health, this will now increase the potential that can recover. All right, so that's definitely a nice improvement. We're gonna most commonly use the axe going forward. So anytime you have the ability to upgrade a weapon, I would prioritize the axe. Once you've used all the regular, what are they called? I'm sorry. Let's see here. Fortify weapon. Once we've used all the regular bloodstone shards, aka getting the hunter axe to +3, then I would suggest using those shards on the saw spear or your other alternate choice of weapon. Okay. And again, you can check the merchant bath here to see if there are any new items that you might be interested in getting. So we see here, we've still got the same weapons as before. I don't suggest buying the Kirk hammer, not for a long time. It's probably not something that you'll want to utilize, considering that you have to put in up to 16 strength to use it. So at this point, the axe is a superior weapon for our scenario. All right, this is important to know. Most people will buy this item thinking that it's a necessity, or that it's mandatory to continue the story. It is not. You do not need to buy this item. In fact, it's just going to get us somewhere where we don't want to go a little bit faster. We want to play out the game going a different route that's going to prepare us, give us more equipment, better gear, more blood echoes, stronger levels, all the good things that we want at the right pace. So this is well planned out, and we're going to avoid this item and save you 10,000 blood echoes at the same time. So this is good for us. Okay, so I forgot that we need to talk to the old lady. She's not at the Cathedral Ward. So before we head out of here, we're going to go to Central Yharnam. Okay. And now we just need to get to the kennel area where all the dogs are at. And there's a couple different ways we can do that. Die. I'm just going to suggest running straight through here. And you're going to get to this side here where we can just fight the doggos. Sometimes you might want to kill this one first, then take out the ones that you can reach. This one up top will come out next. And he's a problem. One day. That's what I thought. Alright, and we'll kill the one that's on the side here. I literally hate the dogs in FromSoft games. They're some of the most difficult enemies to hit. They have insane reflexes. Kind of makes sense. Alright, so for some reason, the dog that's usually here barking at the door is not. And I can't really figure it out because there's not, like, an extra dog over there. So it just seems to be that this dog just doesn't respawn. It's a one-time kill.
So what is it now? I've much better ways to pass the time. Unless you found me a nice safe place.
The crazy thing is she doesn't sound like an old lady right there. It's weird. It's like her voice. She just, I don't know if it's her appearance that tells me that she's such an old lady when I see her the next time. But damn, does she seem ancient when you start dealing with her at the chapel.
Well, what do you know? An outsider worth a lick of salt. Well, don't just stand there. Don't you have work to do? Go slit some throats. Get this mess done with.
Like, listen to that voice. Listen to the anger, the energy in the voice. It just does not match the character that we run into at the chapel. You're about to see that shortly. So again, we can get back to where the lantern is pretty quickly. Don't run up there. That's not what I meant. Just gonna cross this area here. No reason to fight any of this stuff. And we're gonna have to return to the Hunter's Dream. And now, of course, we're going to go back to the Cathedral Ward. Okay, so let's quickly interact with this old, old, ancient lady. I mean, look at this. Look at this. That voice, you would just never think that that was the same person.
Oh, no. I haven't forgotten. Do you think I owe you something? Well, that's a fine lark, I'd say. This old mess that Yharnam's in. It's all your fault. You put it to the outsiders. Our blood's ruined, tainted by your ilk. Don't you come near me. I know your type.
You can almost hear her age. And the crazy thing is, her voice is still muffled like she's behind the door.
You. Stay away from me.
Okay, once she gets to that point, she's going to repeat herself. She still knows all our tricks, apparently. After you've sent her here, you can come talk to this NPC.
Ah, the Hunter. Thank you. So that old girl, you told her about this place, right? Well, she don't offer me much in the way of conversation, but still, I'd rather see her alive anyhow.
Alright, so he gives us triumph. And if you continue to talk to him, he's going to basically reinforce that he'd like you to continue to help by bringing in people.
If you find any sane survivors, well, send them along to Erden Chapel, will ya?
It is funny because he continues to laugh here like he used to, and they would actually put the laughter in the dialogue, but they don't do that here. Alright, so again, we've got a new gesture. If you want to use that, you just press on the left side of the thumb pad, and you'll see you can change out any of the pre-existing ones, just like we did with the shake-off cape. Fancy AF. Alright, so now we are actually at the point where we can start playing in the Cathedral Ward. Just go straight forward. This door over here we can't open just yet, but we're gonna go straight forward, and this is gonna be a dead end, but there's some loot to grab, so we're gonna take advantage of that real quick. There's an enemy here to the right. He sees us already, so let's just shoot him. You can sneak up on this, but he's standing at such an angle with his back to the wagon here, that if you want to land a staggering blow, you're going to have to be about right here to do it and go about it that way. But they're easy enough to kill. It's just the timing with their cane attack is kind of weird. Sometimes they take a very small range of motion to hurt you, so be aware of that. It's a little bit awkward. As you would fight most crows, you're going to want to use your wide range attacks here. Go ahead and grab the loot. And I believe there might be some crows over here. Yep, there's a burb right there. Can take care of this guy no problem. Now you can usually rush them because they'll take time to point at you and make that audible sound. They're basically alerting their other allies to your presence. So if you rush them in that phase, you'll pretty much get a free kill. And I do believe I've mentioned this before, I do not like to parry on stairs, but we don't really have an option here. So this is where you get the wooden shield. We're unable to get this door open at the time. It's actually closed by... Let's see if I can see the lever. There it is, right behind us. So don't worry about that, we'll get that open eventually. But that's the dead end here. So we've done all we can at that point. Now what we're gonna do is head over here behind the old lady. And you're gonna encounter some more of these guys. You can just rush this one if you like. You should be able to get four swings off with your axe and kill it. It's not that my axe would do any more or less damage. The only reason you might not kill it in four swings is if you didn't apply the red brooch. Okay, so once you've killed them, be sure to grab this item over here. Six blood vials is a large pickup, that's really good. And now this loot item here, you cannot take your time with it. You just need to run in there, grab it, and run out. And just watch. That will kill you if you're standing there. There is a beast, a very large beast, that's on the side of this area here, and you can only see it with a certain amount of insight. We're nowhere near that amount, so don't even worry about trying to get there. There's really no incentive for you to be able to see that. Eventually, you will see these things, so that's not like an Easter egg that's always going to be hidden from you. Eventually, regardless of the amount of insight you'll have, you'll figure out what that stuff is that was trying to attack you there. Okay, let's go up here for a quick detour of loot. These guys are tough, they're strong, but you want to fight them around their legs. Try to get in a charged up hit if you can. Occasionally, you'll get a stagger. I'm not sure if they always drop blood vials, but when they do, it's definitely a multiple of them, so they're definitely worth the trade-off. You're never gonna spend 3 blood vials to defeat one, so there are certain enemies that you definitely want to fight. Even if they're a pain in the ass, the reward is worth it. So here we can see only a special emblem opens the main gate. That is the emblem that cost us 10,000 blood echoes. This is what we refuse to spend it on. So we're gonna go around a different way. A lot of people think that that is the normal progression, that you need to get that item to continue, and that's just not the case. So now we can go down here, and this is ultimately a dead end, but it's a valuable one. So we've got a guy roaming over here. We want to let him come to us. We don't want to pursue him because we'll aggro all that other stuff right there. He's just naturally going to turn over here in a second. Let's see. We might actually get to kill him right off the bat. Okay. That's not normally how it would go. I guess I'm normally a little bit more in his vision. Okay, that went poorly. This is why I don't like target lock. Dodging is really hard to get away from stuff. You can see how my dodge only takes me in a basically like a circle. So it prevents me from getting a lot of distance. But when I'm not target locked, I can really get away. I mean, look at the difference between the range of that I'm escaping. All right, so now let's fight this guy normal. Okay, so target lock is very dangerous in certain situations, especially like obviously we would never want to be dodging into this thing. And if we weren't target locked, we would be directing our own dodge, and that's really the trade-off. I target lock sometimes if I feel like I can kill the enemy with a riposte. That wasn't the case there, so it put us in danger. It's just something that you have to realize to disengage when you actually want to evade. You're in such little control of your evasion tactics when you're in target lock. I would say the best tactic for evading while you're target locking is your ability to strafe. It's amazing how much you can dodge just by walking to the side. A lot of these enemies use an extreme amount of momentum going forward, and just walking to the side is a lot more of a space separator than your actual side dodge. Because the side dodge kind of jumps you in a semicircle. So you're moving to the side, but you're never getting much further away to the side. You don't separate yourself, you just kind of reorient yourself. If that's helpful enough for you to understand. Alright, so the monocle is, or monocular, I guess it's properly pronounced, is what you would expect. It's a one-eyed binocular. Monocular, there we go. And it's really good for lining something up like a projectile. So what I would suggest is, let's just say we want to hit this statue. Let's say this statue was some enemy or something that we wanted to hit right there. So I'm going to swap down to my pebble. Boom. Beforehand, we wouldn't have any real way to target that. So it's very good if you want to have precision tosses of certain items. And that will represent itself in a variety of ways throughout the gameplay. But I encourage you to only use that when you're in a safe situation where you have total control, no roaming enemies, because as you can see, when you use this, you've got this crosshair here. Even though my weapon is in my hand, now my vision is completely different than what I'm used to. We can still attack, but we can only get rid of that once we use the square button again to deactivate it. Alright, so now that we're back to Pebble, we can go on forward. That is a really nice score. And we've got this big baddie over here. Now, you're not going to get like a stunning blow on him, but you can land a charged up attack that's going to deal a significant portion of damage. Do not chase the guy behind it. We're just going to try to separate and get another charge up attack. And we're just going to repeat this process as best we can. When he spazzes out like that, it's a good opportunity to land some pretty devastating damage. Alright. Lots of upgrade materials here. This is very good for us early game. So when you see that that little guy that was behind him has disappeared, just like in previous FromSoft games, we can basically reload our file. And we'll be able to see that enemy and kill them promptly. They're a lot easier to get than the shiny lizards from Dark Souls. We get an upgrade material here. And now this door does not do anything. Don't get caught up with that. We can't use that just yet. Or maybe ever. Who knows? Alright, so we're going to go ahead and stand here, reload our save file. Okay, and you can see it right here. It is hard to see. I would never blame anybody for not noticing this thing. As with most enemies in this game, a lot of them just blend into the surroundings. So if they don't become aggressive or move in any way whatsoever, you could literally run by a bunch of enemies and never know it. And those things are definitely some of the harder ones to spot. You usually only see them if they move. Alright, so we are going to head back. We've reached the end of this area. And now we're moving on to the last portion of the zone before we can get to what will eventually be Old Yharnam. So now we're gonna head down the opposite direction here. And if there is an enemy here, it's only because you didn't kill them earlier up top. They do wander down here. So if you're wondering why you see an enemy here and you didn't see an enemy up top, that's the difference. Now there's going to be some roaming enemies, there's some dogs. You want to be careful. You can try to pull them away with like a pebble. I would just suggest letting one or two of them see you. We can probably pull this guy pretty quickly. A little early both times. That's okay, gonna die. Not gonna die. Probably deserve to die. Maybe gonna die. Okay, we might live. And that, my friends, is how a true professional does it. Okay. Wouldn't be a proper episode without some severely embarrassing moments, would it? Curveball the dog. Again, the dogs are tough. The double attack is what really gets me with the dogs. I just always assume that it's going to do the double attack. We can just rush this guy. Most of the enemies, I mean, their swings are so exaggerated. If you just let them miss, you can save yourself the ammo and just go ahead and attack them afterwards. You can definitely play this game in a very slow, methodical pace as far as counterattacking enemies. You don't have to be aggressive, but you can't really do that against bosses or the very tough enemies. So I would definitely suggest getting that out of your system, because you'll be a much better player if you learn how to attack fast and use your parrying and counterattacks properly. Do not go in there yet. There's no reason to go in on the base floor. We're going to go in up top. All right, so if we approach the stairways here, there will eventually come out a dog. You don't want to move up too far, because then you'll get both dogs to come out. Just kind of... there we go. And it doesn't really matter. They both just want to play. Okay. You can hurt them with fire if they walk into it. Sometimes the enemies are dumb. Looks like these have a chase radius. There's a double attack. And there's the dogs from hell that I hate so much. They're just so annoying and fast. They're probably some of the most frustrating enemies to face. Because their dodges are just perfect. There we go. There's the double attack. The double attack is when they're most vulnerable. So if you can get in a fast swing after their double attack, then you're good. If you assume that they're not going to double attack and you try to swing after the first dodge, they're probably going to bite you and you're going to get stagger locked. Basically, anything can stagger lock you in this game. You can hit certain enemies and you won't stagger them, but pretty much everything that attacks you, if it lands a flush hit, it's going to stagger lock you. So the more fast and tiny enemies there are around you, the worse you are for it. So you really want to keep dogs separate from one another. Dogs are probably some of the most overwhelming enemies you can face, because a lot of your swings are going to miss and they're just fast as shit. Obviously, this guy's a rifleman. Nothing new here. We know exactly how to deal with them. The only way this guy is dangerous is if you try to fight those dogs on the stairs. So be smarter than that. And let's continue forward. It's funny how we can just beat a boss's ass, but then when we fight some dogs, it's like a near-death situation. Dogs are dangerous, I totally get it. I see why all those people are afraid of these little puppies now. Alright, let's talk to this NPC here.
You're a beast hunter, aren't you? I knew it. That's precisely how I started out. Oh, beg pardon. You may call me Alfred. Protégé of Master Ligarius. Hunter of vile bloods. So, what say you? Our prey might differ. But we are hunters, the both of us. Why not cooperate and discuss the things we've learned?
All right, so Alfred wants us to do some jolly cooperation, which we gladly accept.
Oh, very good. Very good indeed. Take this to celebrate our acquaintance.
The fire paper is a great item to get from an NPC. I'm sure you can already know what this does. We apply it to our weapon and give it a flame damage property. It's momentary, so it's not going to last forever. Utilize this during boss fights. There's really no reason to use it in the open world. And we also get the prey gesture.
Beast hunting is a sacred practice. May the good blood guide your way.
Okay, now if we continue to converse with Alfred here, we're going to be able to ask him questions about areas we're interested in going forward.
There must be oodles for us to share. Go on, just tell me what piques your interest.
So let's get a little bit of information about these two locations.
As you know, the Healing Church is the fountainhead of blood healing. Well, I'm a simple hunter, quite unfamiliar with the ins and outs of the institution. But I have heard that the holy medium of blood healing is venerated in the main cathedral, and that counselors of the old church reside in the high stratum of the cathedral ward. If you seek blood healing, and the church is willing, you should pay them a visit.
Okay, and now let's learn about Bergenworth.
Bergenworth is an old place of learning, and the tomb of the gods carved out below Yharnam should be familiar to every hunter. Well, once a group of young Bergenworth scholars discovered a holy medium deep within the tomb. This led to the founding of the Healing Church and the establishment of blood healing. In this sense, everything sacred in Yharnam can be traced back to Bergenworth. But today, the college lies deep within a tangled wood, abandoned and decrepit. And furthermore, the Healing Church has declared Bergenworth forbidden ground. It's unclear how many of its scholars remain alive, but only they know the password that allows passage through the gate.
Okay. And that's our first introduction to a place that actually requires a password. And we obtain that password by defeating Vikar, one of the bosses. I don't personally think that boss is tough, especially with the axe and the fire paper. But some of the players think it's a little bit more difficult. And defeating that boss will give us the password to proceed to that forest. So we'll deal with that as it approaches.
Bid you farewell. It has been a pleasure. May the good blood guide your way.
Alright. So for now, that's all we need from him. We're gonna go ahead and proceed forward. We'll go down this area here. There's this lever, but there's also this item. So let's grab that. You can hear some footsteps below. That definitely gives you the indication that there are enemies down there. So what I like to do is roll towards the sound. When we're rolling, we have an opportunity for a faster attack like that. If we're just walking towards an enemy and swing, it's a much slower animation. So especially when I drop down from something and take like a small amount of fall damage, I want to try to engage as quickly as possible so that I can recover that damage. Alright, so we've obtained what we were looking for here. We're going to go down below. Now there's going to be a beast. And it's in the next room. So when we get to the bottom, I believe they're located on the left side. So you want to be a little cautious. But the beasts are really easy to fight, so don't worry too much. It's just one. If there's more than one, they're tough, but... as I take damage for no reason. I wanted to parry it. Its first attack is always hard for me to parry. I was trying to cool guy it, but I'll just go the easy way. And here we get, this might be our first beast pellet, actually. Let's see. There it is. Okay, yeah, it is our first one. Large medicinal pellets, supposedly formed of coagulated beast blood. Banned by the Healing Church due to their unclear origin, grants a spurt of beasthood, ripping apart the flesh of one's enemies and being rained upon by their splattering blood invigorates one's sense of beasthood, feeding strength and euphoric feeling alike. All right. Interesting stuff. Okay, so we're basically getting down to the bottom area here. There's going to be an item on that little overhang. Oops, I thought I hit the bottom. We're gonna run up the stairs and grab that. Antidote is gonna help us with poison buildup. Either you're poisoned or you want to reduce the buildup as it accumulates. That's gonna be important in the next area. Typically when the game gives you specific items that you haven't received yet, it's usually foreshadowing, so take that into consideration. Go ahead and activate the lamp. And there's a couple, at least one, there might be more than one item. Let's see, we got pungent cocktail. And it might be the only item. Yeah, okay. That is it. Now, old Yharnam is behind that door. We don't need to open that at the moment. We've got one more thing to do. Okay, so we have picked up plenty of bloodstone shards. Plenty of them. So we're going to need to upgrade our axe. As you can see here, we have 17 in our inventory now. So that is a big reason why we went the path we did. We can give quite a boost to our weaponry. Alright, and we did get some more blood gems. So let's make sure to utilize those as best we can. So we already have the red blood gem equipped in our first slot. So just move over to the second slot. And we're going to figure out which one we want best here. You can see the level of rarity for the gem by the number to the right of that purple symbol. So if you look here, we've got a rarity of 4 on the blood gem. And then the two above it are rarity level 1s. When we move over here, we don't see the blood gem anymore because it's already equipped. So we now need to decide which one we want to equip here. These, even though they have the same rarity, are very different. This one is a physical attack up by 0.7%, which you can see over in the center right. This one is the same stat, but by plus 1.1, so it's already improvement. And it has an additional modifier of the hit points continue to recover plus 1. So just at rest, by standing around not doing anything, you're going to slowly generate health. So that's very important for us. So what we can do is we can create some blood bullets. And you can see the symbol on my character, that blue skeleton with the up arrow. Now if we look at our hit point pool in the center upper area, you can see that it is slowly going to climb. So that is a great thing to just have. Now the rate at which you regain health is very slow. However, it's already an improvement to the other option we had, and it's better than nothing, that's for sure. Okay. And I just used the blood bullets just to show you that healing process, but we're not really going to be able to benefit from that too much. All right. So now what we're going to do is go ahead and channel some blood echoes. Oops. Perfect.
Farewell, good hunter. May you...
All right, so one last thing that I want to show you. We're going to go back to the first floor sick room. We've got Yosefka's quest, essentially, to deal with. And there's a little twist on it. Okay, so we return up the stairs just like we did in the first episode. And I want you to pay attention to Yosefka and see if you can notice anything out of the ordinary here.
Oh, well, hello. Splendid. Let me ask you a small kindness. You're soon off to hunt, I presume? Then, if you find any survivors, tell them to seek Yosefka's clinic. Upon my Hippocratic oath, if they are yet human, I will look after them. Perhaps even cure them. This sickness, these beasts, they are not to be feared. This time the night is long. I may be trapped here, but I should do something to help. I'll even offer a reward for your cooperation. Tempted? Well, off you go then.
Okay, so the conversation we have with her here is clearly different than the conversation we last had. She didn't want anything to do with hunters or even any civilians outside. Anyone that could potentially bring in infection into the clinic that she's currently dealing with patients. She values them way more than anything else. And she was really trying to get rid of us by giving us the health file before. Now, the health file that we got earlier, Yosefka's health file, if you use that before the Gascoin fight, before you basically access the chapel ward, you can come back and get more of them from her. You can only have one at a time, but you can get essentially an infinite amount of refills each time. So I can't really say there's any reason to use it, but still, if you want to use it before then, go ahead. I would rather save it for a tough fight and just have the one than use it early and often to where you can keep getting refills, because the game just doesn't necessitate the need for that kind of thing early on. But that being said, let's get to the bottom of why she is different and what's going on. There's really no way to figure that out, but it should send up red flags And earlier I was talking to you about being able to send people to the chapel for protection. Do not send them here. Even though we initially trusted Yosefka because she was helpful to us and very blunt and honest about the situation, she's completely changed her tone and her message in a very short period of time. So something is off about this. And she's basically bribing you to send people here, rewarding you for doing that, whereas before she had the exact opposite tone. So we know that something is wrong here, even though we don't know the details behind it. Next time we save a civilian, we'll be posed with the chance to send them here or to the chapel. Send them to the chapel every time, except for one individual who I will be sure to clearly identify when we approach them. So when we get to that point, you will know. But until then, go ahead and send the individuals here. Or I'm sorry, to the chapel. Do not send them here. And I don't want to spoil what's going on, but just know that there is something going on. And when we get to it, it'll reveal itself. So other than that, we can try to talk to her again if you like.
If you find anyone who's still human, send them straight to Yosefka's clinic. You can assure them there's no place safer. Please, do me this service.
And again, just reinforcing the exact opposite sentiment from earlier. Okay, so now that we've discussed that with her, next time we find a civilian who's looking for a safe place, they're going to have those two options, Yosefka's clinic or the chapel ward. So basically we've got those options. All right, so this is essentially the end of episode 2. Next episode, we're going to clear out Old Yharnam. We're doing this in a very specific order to get you the best gear and the most prepared before you fight certain boss fights, and also to make sure that you're not advancing any quest lines without properly dealing with them beforehand. So if you're wondering why we might be taking different paths than some of you have taken before, there are reasons behind this. Thank you guys so much for joining. Sorry for any of the casual mistakes I make during gameplay. I try to do it with as little editing as possible, so sometimes there might be a hiccup there where I need to make a quick cut with an explanation, but as you can see, we don't need to do that too often because everything's going smoothly for the most part. We'll see you in the next one, everybody. I appreciate it, and take it easy.